I think we're ready to go live. I think we're ready to go live. And we've got Jeff. He was almost late, but he really wasn't late. So it really doesn't count. So we can't even count him being late. You can't be tardy here. It just doesn't work. Kabam! What's up tonight? We've got a couple announcements to make a little later. We got Jeff coming on. He's going to talk about maybe a location, and everybody knows what today is. I know you know what time it is, or what. Yeah, it's 4:20. I saw that on Facebook from Joe B, and I was like, that's pretty damn funny. We got Carlos Martinez, and we got Kim here. Tom R, what is up tonight? How's everybody doing? Man, what a great show last week. That was so much fun talking to our author in charge that came in to see us. What a cool, Mr. Hutton was absolutely a really cool guy. We got more. I'm trying to switch it up every other time. We're trying to make some stuff happen a little differently, going after different people. Been working pretty difficultly hard, not difficultly hard, something like that, but we've been working on it, trying to get a whole group of people to come on here, and then we'll see where that ends up going. Tonight's show is going to be about, we're going to start off talking basically about our next trip. I'm not going to call it a meetup. I'm just going to call it that me and Jeff are going to show up in a location, and Kim, we're going to do that at the end. The no-show blues will be at the end at the 4:20. So we're going to jump on top of that, and we're going to talk about the location that we have absolutely decided that we're going to go to. Now, that being said, we hope we have guests and we hope we have company. And I'm going to bring Jeff in here, and hey, Keith, what's up? I'm glad you're here. So I'm going to bring Jeff in here. Archeology, Jeff. He should have some type of song. He should have a song. I don't even know what the hell it'd be, but you know, he should have. Yeah, he should come in like that. That should be the way he comes in. He should be rocking it hard when he comes in. We got archaeologist Jeff in the house. Jeff, what's up, man? How you doing?
Hey, I'm doing good. How about yourself?
Good. Do we got different pictures, or are we in a different location? I don't remember those pictures.
Oh, yeah. Well, no, actually, now that it doesn't get dark early, you can actually see them before it got dark, but it's the same pictures.
We've even got Steve Lines here tonight. How incredible is that? We've got Steve Lines. He's even here to see us. So we've been talking quite a bit about the difficulties with some meetups, the liabilities of some meetups, things like that. But we know we wanted to do it. We know we needed to do it. But we got a different way to do it. We're just, me and you're going to show up in a location. We're going to tell everybody, though. It's not going to be some type of secret. And then anyone that would like to come along, well, guess what? But you might want to tell people, where are we going, Jeff? First off, let's tell everybody where we're going.
Yeah, so we are going to meet in the Verde Valley, and we are going to cross a river, the Verde River, which we'll get into here in a minute. Don't worry, it's going to be fun because it's going to be hot down there. But yeah, we're going to a few Sanawa sites, so prehistoric Sanawa, about AD 700 to 1300, they were in the Verde Valley.
So why do they call it the Dirty Verde?
The Dirty Verde. Well, we'll find out.
I can tell you why, because it's filthy. I said, I don't know what they did to it, but it's filthy. I don't think it'll leave a stain on you, but it is filthy. So I'm just going to throw that out there. I don't know why, but it's not. It wouldn't be a fun. I just wouldn't go swimming in the dirty Verde. I'll put it that way. Tim here. Tim, what's going on?
Yeah, it's a little bit of a mud pit, huh? The crawdads do really well out there, mud bugs.
You know, before we get going real quick, I would like to throw up this from last week real quick. I want to thank Mr. Lyons and Mr. Barry for their kind donations to keep us on the road and keep us happy. And the Dirty Birdie got, oh my God, the Dirty Birdie got money. So here's what he's going to get. Now here's some new stuff he's going to get something, Jeff, that, he's going to get this one. Bam. Bam. So, well, you know, you know, what's funny, you know, this should be fun, right? That's the reality of this. I mean, it should be fun going out. It should be fun going exploring. Yeah. It should be fun to talk about this stuff. It shouldn't be serious. And, you know, I guess there's parts of it that can be serious, the preservation part. But as far as going out and having fun, it's so stuffy. And so that's one of the reasons today when we talked about how many – These archaeologists, right, that I started to research and we started to look at. And most of these guys, what they have in common is they're average guys that just love this. They're not trained professionals. They learned as they went. They had this desire to go and seek these places, and they did. And as they went, because they had such a high passion, they learned. And they became the original guys in the state of Arizona that actually really did the archaeologists, the early archaeology digs, things like that, were guys that just loved, you know, Cosmos Mindleff, who's the Covates are named after, and we've talked about before. He wasn't an archaeologist. He came out here because he was going to help the Casa Grande ruins. They were going to stabilize it, and then they ran out of money. Now, he was into the mining side of it, but he kind of got into that, and then all of a sudden, he dug 50 sites. And so the Covates, he documented every room in those Covates. I mean, every room. On the debates. And so it's incredible the work that he did. One thing I want to say also too is all the Facebook people, you don't show up. Some of your comments don't show up. So don't think we're not throwing you up. Now this one did, but you don't know who it is. So if you want to throw your name up there, that's perfect. Wendy is going to ride on Steve Lyne's shoulders. I might be on Steve Lyons' shoulders. Steve Lyons is so tall, Jeff, that like it'll be ankles.
How tall is he?
I mean, it's like he is related to the giants that we talk about. Absolutely. He's got to be 6'8". 6'7", 6'8".
Hey, that's good because we're going to be crossing water that goes up to about chest level, you know, for a 6 foot person, maybe a little bit lower. But you know what? It's going to be a blast. It's going to be a day where we just go out, we poke around, we have fun, we talk, we interact with each other. We talk a little bit about the history, of course. And, hey, you know what? Depending on what kind of wild plants are out there, I might whip us up a wild plant salad if anybody is interested in that. So, yeah, it's just going to be a great time.
Oh, wait a minute. You ain't getting by that easy. Hold on. What are you talking about, a wild plant salad? Okay.
Yeah, well, Well,
and this Wendy, I know what you're thinking, and don't even say it. Okay, I know what Wendy's going to throw out there. If Steve doesn't, don't even do it. I know what they got. I know what's coming. Now go ahead with this tossed salad.
Sure. So I got Wendy. Oh, that's awful. Last weekend I was actually down at the Verde River doing some camping, and I noticed that there's a lot of wild edible plants out right now. We have plantain, we have wood sorrel, we have stinging nettle. We have a plethora of plants that we can actually, even lamb's quarter, that we can harvest wild and mix it up with a salad dressing and eat like the natives did, because they had to have greens too. And some of these plants are native to the areas. Others are not. They're European induced, but nonetheless, they are completely edible. And they're really, really healthy for us in vitamins as well as protein. So we can take a step back in time and whip up a wild tossed salad.
I love how you threw that in there. We got Ken Bush's head. I've seen Ken and Tim's in. Man, we got the house. We got almost the full house tonight. And Wendy, what'd she say? Oh, he's edible. Everybody thinks it's 420 since it's 420 today. I don't know what. Oh, they're edible. They think. Now, the ancients did partake in some. Do you see much signs of any peyote, anything like that, in this area at all? And I'm not trying to be funny, but I know that was a part of a lot of the.
There's peyote is actually further east, from my understanding. They actually took part in Datura or gypsum weed ceremony. And there's actually, and we can talk about it while we go out there, there's actually some pottery vessels that are the shape and style of, it's a very good resemblance of a Datura or gypsum weed seed pod.
So I have heard of Datura as being something that when you're getting into a trance state of some type, do you make a tea out of it of some type? Is that accurate?
You got to be careful with that.
Well, it's poison, like all good drugs. It's poison.
Well, I mean, this stuff is pretty potent. There was a couple kids years back in the 90s that went out to Joshua Tree National Park, and they tried experimenting with Datura. They actually consumed it in a tea, but they also smoked the seeds, and that put them in cardiac arrest, and all of them died. So you got to be really careful. But yeah, they knew how to use it, and they knew how to use it wisely, I guess you can say. We won't be partaking in any of that on any this trip. But nonetheless, it was definitely used.
So one thing to everybody should know is that we are going to cross the river. The river can be, depending on your height, anywhere from chest under the armpits to higher or lower, depending on. And now that's where it hit me. I think it hit me right here, right at the mid chest is where it hit me. I don't know where it's at right now. It's going to be difficult to get out. You're going to get wet. If you have a phone in your pocket, it's going to be soaked. But the reason to go across, so why would you go across the river versus the other way? There are two ways into the Cavites. There is the upper level. You can actually go from the top down, and then you can also go across the river. Now, after doing both and crossing the river, the Dirty Verde, I would cross the Dirty Verde 15 times before I'd even consider going from the top down. It is actually pretty treacherous coming in from the bottom or from the top down. And you have to find the right place to come in, because you've got that wall of Cavites. you know, that go right. all the way around. So they use that middle section. So what happened, from what I understand, is that the way the sediment and the way the earth was formed is that's a shelf of softer stone that set in there because of it being underwater. And so that's what they carved out, was that middle layer, which was a lot easier to carve out. They're really pretty damn cool. I mean, they are extremely cool.
These are really fascinating sites, and it's not like there's just one or two of them. There are many sites out there, and they're like little cave alcoves. But yeah, we do have to cross water. My recommendation for anybody that is thinking about going and is unsure about the water level, it can't hurt to bring a life jacket, to be honest with you. But we're going to take it nice and slow. Once we hit the water, we'll slowly work our way in and creep. There's no rush to get there. We have all day to get there. But once we cross the river, it's pretty easy going. But yeah, just we're going to take our time. If anybody's concerned about it, like I said, bring a life jacket. You know, at Big Five or Walmart, they carry those noodles. You know what I'm talking about, yeah, Jeff? Those pool noodles. That Absolutely. Might not be a bad idea either.
Well, if you, and you can watch the video of me going across it and all the places I tried to find the best route, and I got deeper than what you see, where I finally found what I thought was going to be the easier place. I was also told from another gentleman that there's another location that actually is lower on down. And if anybody does know that location of where exactly that's at, let me know. And now the only thing that's difficult is getting out, because the bank is not a bank that is, like a lake bank where you can walk out and it's actually the deep end of the river. So the way right. that it flows, it's the deep side. The other side is the side where we go in, is where you kind of walk right out eventually. This is not. You go to the deepest part, that's that bank, and then you've got to get out. Now, we can help people get out and things like that. Now, right. why would we go that route? The main reason is that it's 50 times easier. It's really not even a hike. You're two blocks. Once you get across the river and you get to that part, you're two blocks. I mean, you're two blocks from everything. And go ahead.
I was just going to say, here's my recommendation for crossing it. There's two things that I would highly recommend bringing, and we'll go over, Jeff and I will go over a recommended gear kit that we advise bringing for this particular outing. So there's two things. I would bring a pair of shoes, good pair of hiking boots, of course. But when you're in the water, if you have a breathable sandal, not a flip-flop, but a sandal that actually has straps that kind of lock your foot. Everybody knows what I'm talking about. Those water sandals or even a water shoe would work. Something that is breathable, that isn't going to puddle water up, but that you can actually grip onto the rocks, that would be a good idea. So bring a pair of hiking boots and also a pair of sandals that have those Velcro straps that strap over, or the tie-down straps that go over, and you'll be just fine. I just want everyone to have a good solid footing when they go right over that river.
Well, you know, and if you go back to the video, I just threw my hiking boots around my neck. You know, I had an old pair of tennis shoes. I knew I was going to get wet. You know, I knew I took everything out. I put everything in a pack, and then I put it over my head. You know, the thing with me was I really didn't know how deep it was going to be, though. That's the only thing with me is I didn't know how deep it was going to get. I got in some places it was pretty damn deep, and that's what I realized. I wasn't going to go that route. But a guy did tell me later on, there's a couple places that are better to cross. I never got to find out where that was at, but it's not. I mean, once you get out, then you're there. I mean, it's not like, you know, you go through a hell of a lot of hiking. I mean, you're there, and I've been there twice now, and I haven't been through a tenth of the Cavites. I haven't been to a tenth of them. I probably have been less than a tenth. I think there's a man, I want to throw a number like 160, but it might be 200. But they're in different levels. I mean, they're different sizes. But you will get into stuff that's pretty incredible. Now, some of them are terrible because some of them have bats in them. And so, you know, that's one of the reasons I've stayed out of some of them is you're going to want a mask. You're going to want to wear a mask, and you're going to want a flashlight because you get into these rooms. And even if you find one without a bat living in it, they still, you can't see. I mean, they're fairly big rooms, most of them. And that's what makes this such an incredible trip. And a lot of them are connected like one after another. You can go through five or six of them as they ran the tunnel system, you know, between them, which is pretty incredible. I mean, it really is a special place that you just don't get to see things like this.
I want to reiterate the mask thing. If there are bats inside, yeah, wearing a mask, an N95 really works well. You know, those cheap little paper masks that, you know, COVID just blows right through. I would probably recommend a N95 or a KN95, something that's going to suction onto your face, that's going to protect you. But yeah, it's going to be a great time. These are really fascinating sites. I'm expecting to find pottery, so we'll find a lot of plainware up there. Some of them have black smudged interiors. And then we might even find a few decorated sherds that are black on white that came from the Mogollon Rim and was actually transported and traded into the Flagstaff Verde Valley region. So yeah, we'll be on the lookout for that. Of course, we'll talk about some of the features, you know, pick my brain, pick Jeff's brain. It's just a good time to get together. Another thing about crossing this river is, yeah, we will definitely help each other out. And I can even run downstream to see if there's a little bit more of a clear path. Now, the river, last time Jeff went, it was up to, you know, up to his chest, maybe a little bit lower into the abdomen. But it could be lower. It could be lower. We are definitely in a drought, but the Verde River is managed to where they actually let in steady flows of water. If that water is moving, I want everyone to hear me really carefully here, because it can actually make you dizzy and cause you to get off balance. If the water is moving, you look straight ahead at the vegetation. You do not look at the water, because that messes up your whole equilibrium. You have a chance to, like I said, fall, slip on a rock, and then, you know, you don't want to get that. So if it is moving, look straight ahead, look at the vegetation, and we'll go over all of this before we cross.
And in the area that we went, or I went before, it really wasn't an issue. It was a real, it was a place that was in between, but it did make it a little deeper. So that was one part of it too. And we'll just have to see him call it by ear. But I tell you what, it's an incredible place. It really is an incredible place. There is not a lot of places that I've ever been like this. And you know, what's fun about it is you get that Indiana Jones crossing the river and the camel man, just like we talked about the camel cigarette guys when they used to have their adventure teams, and you kind of get a feel for that. But you also get a really easy hike because you're not coming from the top. And I'm telling you what, getting out of there about killed me, because I don't know if we talked about this. I know in my head, I talked to somebody about it, but we came in from the south side down from the top. And it took us forever to find an area to get down, because it's a cliff wall all the way around. I mean, that's what they dug out. So we finally found the path in it. And as far as I know, there's only one path down coming from the top. So when we went through all the stuff, there was a cool, like, dry creek that ran through the middle of the Kamates. And we went, well, you know, we know where it goes. It goes back up. I mean, I know it's going to go end up back on the, so let's just take that. That was like the biggest mistake that I ever made in my entire life. You talk about a bitch getting out of there. It was brutal. So when the idea of the water came up and remembering that and thinking, okay, well, the water, because I mean, once you get across the water, you're there. I mean, there's no real hiking. I mean, you're right there. And so then you got, now the other thing that you want to be careful of, I have not seen a snake there, but they will be snakes. So clear the rooms. I haven't run into any, but I have seen videos of people there they found snakes. I mean, you're going to be in a place that you need to clear the room before you go in. And remember, there are hundreds of these rooms. So it's not like you're looking at one or two. I mean, there are hundreds of these cavates. Let me play a little bit of the video. So if they haven't seen it, we won't get into super big depth with it, but let's just get into some of this. And at least we'll start, we'll bounce back and forth. I wasn't going to make this entire show about this, but let's get in and see a little bit about.
Where are we at today? We are at the Mindless Cavates. Cavates basically means a man-made cave. And so we're back. We've been here.
Well, we got an ad for Hershey. So when you're going.
Hey, there's the Verde River.
Watch the Oscars.
And the live Oscars. You can see that as well. That. So there is basically, that's the dirty Verde right there. It's not, it's there's a distance there. So it's not like, now you have to crawl in these, we have to find a path through these willows right there. There was my setup, and you can lose 30 pounds in the first 90 days. You'll notice that right there. So let's get it. We're going to move on forward.
One of the positive we're dealing with right now.
Now that's when I was trying to find a way out. Because I got across, but I couldn't find a way out. Terrible.
The bottom's fairly rough.
Jeff, I'm going to add one thing. So that's you're in the river right now. Like I said earlier, it's going to be a little bit warm out there. This last weekend, it was 85 degrees, almost 90 degrees.
Yeah, and so, you know, I mean, it's not just a hop, skip, and a jump, even though it's not like you can see that we're about where the water is. I made a couple different attempts. I couldn't get out, and then I'm trying to figure out where I decided to finally make the shot out. And there I went right there.
Water is going to get a little deeper, and that's going to get a little we're going to go up.
See, and I didn't know what I was going to get into. I didn't know if I was going to fall into a hole or, you know, I didn't know what it was going to be like.
I'm going to give you guys a view.
And then you also got to be shooting the camera.
So you can see what we're at.
So then you got to find a way out. So I dug through there, and there you can see right there, I saw a little animal trail.
Muddy,
and then that's how you get out. And that wasn't too bad, but there were places where I couldn't get out. So that's one of the reasons I took that shot to get out there.
Over here.
So that's, you know.
It looks like somebody broke that down at one time.
So you basically just crawl through the weeds. And there's a lip right there. And then you're also at the deepest part of the river. But, you know, when we get people on the banks, then you can, you know, it's going to be a lot easier because you can really get it figured out. But then once you pop out, you're there.
I might
so,
just start
you know, that's what's cool about it is,
come back
is once you get out, you only walk across that distance right there that you see.
Unbelievable.
And there's an ad coming, another ad. So we'll kill that and stop and we'll go back to, yeah. So right there, that's, you know, that's the journey, which really is not bad. I mean, it really isn't, but it was kind of fun.
Yeah, absolutely. That, you know what? I'll tell you, last weekend when I went to the Verde River and I went on my camping trip, it was warm. It was 85, 90 degrees. It's going to be about the same, maybe even a little bit warmer. So trust me, folks, this river is going to be nice. It's going to cool you down. And we'll just have a lot of fun there. And then what we can also do is if people are concerned about that embankment, I'll bring some thicker rope, or maybe, you know, Jeff and I will collaborate about that. We can actually help pull you up with that rope. We could tie it around a tree or something.
And I've seen videos of people that's actually used blow up boats or whatever. That's not impossible. Yeah. And just by the time, you know, I feel it's not that, you know, you're talking about in and out and out in 5 minutes.
Easy.
You know,
easy. And the sights. The sights are going to be amazing. I'm telling you, your audience is going to like them. And anybody that wants to go on an adventure and check out some of the local prehistory, this is the trip for you. It's 100% free. What I will tell you is there's a few things that I would bring. So number one is obvious, water. Bring water, bring quite a bit of water. You don't want to drink from the Verde River. It might look like that Hershey's milkshake, but it doesn't taste like
it. Trust me. Like it. No.
So bring water. Bring a pack lunch. You know, maybe something sweet to snack on. You know, bring a pack lunch. Sunblock, a wide-brimmed hat to keep the sun off your face. I would probably bring a pocket knife, a bandana, a first aid kit. I believe I said sunblock already, a hank of rope.
Flashlight. You are going to be in, these are caves. These are cavates. They're man-made caves. And you will get in there and it will be dark. I mean, it will be dark. And some of them are unbelievably bad smelling.
And a mask. Bring a mask.
Absolutely. And if you want, I got some video of some of them, the part two of that. Whenever you want to play that, we can show people what they're going to be getting into if you want. I mean, so they know exactly once you get up there. What I'm going to do is I'm just going to change shoes. I'm going to have my dry pair of socks, shoes. I'm going to have a towel in my backpack. I'm going to dry off, get my feet dry, put on a pair of socks, and then another pair of hiking boots. And then by the time you spend about 30, 40 minutes, you will be dry. So you will be dry by the time you, you get there. But, whenever you're ready, I'll throw up that second one and show people what it looks like inside. You ready?
I'm ready.
Let's go. Let's do this. Okay. Let's get in here and then let's get to, that's part two. I believe that's it. No, that's not it. Well, but I've got the cavates in here. So even though we show the rest, I'll back up and we'll get to it. And then one
of the most unique places that we've been where they've actually carved, you know, their homes out of this rock.
Now all along that ridgeline, all the way around. Now we're on the south end right there of that ridgeline. But if you'll notice, those caves are all the way around, all the way around this.
Now what we're going to do is we're going to go in. This is the first one.
If you follow that, you know, all the way around from the south end to the north end, these caves are all the way through there. You could spend a week going through every one of these if you wanted to. And that's what makes that incredible.
And this is like the upper level. Let's go in this cave. Now, one thing we're noticing already is man, it's big and it's dark in there. So let's go in and take a look and see what we got. But I tell you what, this thing is huge. And if you don't have light, you're not going to be able to see in here. First thing I do is check for snake. No snakes, James. You can tell there's been bats in here.
See, look at the size of that thing. You're not expecting that when you go in.
Now, here is a room back here. Man. There's like no air in here. You see back in here, James? Now, this is the first building, but
bats hanging.
Oh, yeah, there is a bat. There's bats on the ceiling. That's the name of a band, isn't it? Yeah. Look here. So, man, it's nasty in here. I can tell you that. They didn't have bats, though. So, be prepared for that. Look at this. This is incredible. Let's look over here. I'm sure they had ladders, but this is definitely one that does not have a...
Now, this here is more on the north side as you walk down the ridge line. We were on the south than the first ones.
They're just endless, endless rooms. Now, this little area was carved out over here. This is really unbelievable. I can't even, there's a little hole there. And, you know, it's kind of like doing abandoned stuff. You ever done abandoned stuff? But it's, man, this is somebody's home. People, they raised their families here. They had lives here. And, you know, so you kind of feel privileged to be able to spend a little time in someone's home. Hey, I F-bombed the bats, James, because the thing is the coolest ones, the biggest ones you stumble on, definitely are also the ones that the bats like the best as well. Now, I can tell you, there ain't been anybody in this room for a long time. The tracks that are...
Yeah, that's wild smell.
Oh, it's bad.
Be careful on that one, dude. Don't breathe too much.
The problem is I have to go in it, though.
Yeah, okay. But yeah, just be careful, dude.
This is unbelievable. Look at this thing.
Look how big that thing is. You know,
hell did they put in that little hole? What did they put in that little hole?
I'm sure you'll get a good comment. I don't know.
Well, this doesn't even look like material. Is your camera on? There's two rooms back there. Now look over here, James. There's another room back there.
Oh, yeah.
So let's...
Now look at this, what we found, right? It's coming up right there. Look at the bottom. Look what's in the bottom of there. Isn't that incredible?
I'll tell you what, crawling through those four rooms was probably one of the neatest things I've done for a while. What about you, James?
Yeah, that's pretty awesome.
I tell you what, because I thought we were dead-ended, and I thought I was going to have to kind of – I actually had planned in my head I was going to crawl across that cliff face, right? And then I saw that hole, and I looked around, and I saw that hole, and I was like, man, you definitely, if you're going to do this, you definitely better be ready to crawl. And then you also probably ought to be ready to make sure that you got a flashlight, because I tell you what, you're going to need one and you're not going to be able to. And getting up here wasn't easy. And getting down could go one of two ways. But how cool is this?
Now, on the very point,
wow,
on the south,
this is
side is what this is. This is on its own point. So you walk through that's here and special. You come through this room, which is incredible.
What a breeze. Oh, man.
Now you can look. There's the river right there. So that's the distance that you basically have to walk. There is some shards.
What did you say? Oh. Only was dug.
There was a well.
There's no doubt that it was dug. And so when you look in here and you see
or a
this,
cistern, I should call
I'm
it,
guessing maybe is what I'm guessing it was. Off the roof. Now, that's a guess, but this definitely looks like it held water. And you can definitely tell it was carved.
That is an incredible place. Absolutely.
That's cool.
Oh, Joe B. just rolled in. He just got off work, and he just came in. We got Big Chamook. I never known him. Cool. Went to court. So... That's where we're going. And is it going to be this Sunday or is it going to be next Sunday, Jeff?
So we're going to go next Sunday. We want to give everybody plenty of time and opportunity to plan accordingly. We were going to go this Sunday, but I feel it's rapidly approaching. We got to give folks time. Boy, I got to tell you, Jeff, you know what? Travel Channel needs to pick you up for some of these adventures. I'm telling you, man, you do a good job at those.
Well, it's pretty easy to do, you know, when you just loved it. I mean, when you get to go to places like that, and you know, these, it's so interesting that it was so close. I mean, yeah, you'd have to cross the river, but when you get there and these cavates are so that last room, they're all connected. So I'm thinking, do I got to go out on the ledge and kind of climb this ledge around? And I got in there and all of a sudden, man, they're connected. So they're all, you walk through four houses to that point where you could look out. And then the very point was that rock where you could see through it. And then that cistern is what I'm guessing it was. And to find that corn, I mean, the place is just unreal. It really is. And, you know,
it's way cool. It's so cool. Yeah, we're going to have a blast out there, man. And I think your viewers will too. It's going to be great.
Hey, Dean had a little, had a little injury. So we wish him a speedy recover. Dean from my Arizona Timeless Tour did a little knee twist. I understand what that's like when you go do this, that's part of what happens. So we hope that Dean gets well fast. I hope Dean gets to come on this. Dean gets to, you know, it's a short trip. Well, I'll carry him across the river if I have to.
That'd be great. That'd be great. You know, one thing that I'm thinking about doing, Jeff, and we can talk about it a little bit more. I can actually put this trip on my website. Now, again, it's not a formal meetup, but we're going to be out there and, you know, I'll put it on my website and we'll have, you know, things that we recommend bringing, you know, a little bit about it. And anybody that's interested can go pop on there. And, you know, it's not like we're going to take signups. It just tells you what we recommend bringing, what time to meet, where to meet, and then we'll go out from there. This is nothing formal. It's not a class or anything, but it just gives you a little bit of information, when to meet, where to meet, you know, how long we'll be out there, so forth and so on.
Well, you know, the great thing about these is, you know, everybody can be on their own too. You know, hey, if you want to go do this or want to go left, you know, it's not formal. Yeah. It's not some type of formal deal. Now, here's the great news. You don't even need a truck. You can have a two-wheel drive car. It's 90% paved. And the last stretch, there's a couple holes here or there, but it's not off-road at all. You can bring a car. So 99% of your trip from Phoenix or Prescott is on pavement. So this isn't even off road. That's what's so crazy about this. Now there is a bonus. Also, there are more cavates near there that there's no water, but from what I've seen, I've not been to them. They're not as cool because they're right off the highway. You just pull off the highway and walk up there. But they're the same kind of deal because they also found that area where they could carve. And so, yeah, I mean, that's going to be fun. I can't wait. Now, Jeff, the bonus of sight that's there as well. I didn't pull that video up. I should have, but I didn't. As I was doing the research, and we do this stuff, and you're looking at, you know, the cavates, and you're looking at Cosmos Mindliff. Cosmos Mindliff was the gentleman that about 1890, 93, somewhere in there, he was the first guy to go through here and document this. Those are named after him, and he had the greatest name for an archaeologist in the United States of America, Cosmos. Was his first name, and the guy again was not even a bona fide, taking a line from a movie, archaeologist, and he got that way by the time he got done with 50 sites. I mean, he did the White House, he did everything, he did all these special locations when he was done, and that's what this is named after, is him. And him and his wife did this, and they documented and they drew pictures of every cavate. Now, the bonus is this. When we were looking up all the information and I was doing my research and we went down the rabbit hole, what I found out was there is a mine there on the way in. So you turn off the highway once you get into town and you take this southern route and you pass an area that I'd passed twice and didn't even know it was there. And it is the location of the oldest mine in the United States. And that's a typo. It's the oldest mine in the United States. That doesn't even seem possible. I looked at it 50 times when I saw it, and I was like, how could this even be? And it's a salt mine, and they've been
doing these
things for thousands and thousands and thousands of years. Now, the area is still there. The mine has been sealed. But, I mean, ancients went to that place forever. The salt of the earth, these old sayings. If you had salt, that was the key ingredient for everything, right? I mean, that was, you know, between that and the matate, those were staples of staying alive, right? They found how many mummies in that cave, Jeff?
Well, last I heard, I think that they found close to, I want to say it was almost 12 mummies in there, Sanawa mummies. There's lots of stories about early explorers going in and digging them up and then actually transporting them back east. So there's a little bit of confusion there, but nonetheless, we know that salt preserves things. And some of the items that they found associated with the bodies are incredible. Woven baskets, all kinds of perishables, prayer sticks, fire sticks, sandals, all kinds of cool stuff, human hair, handles to axes with the axes still mounted into it. So yeah, all that stuff really preserves well with the salt. And yeah, the salt mine is, I knew you were going to say it. The salt mine is definitely the oldest mine in the United States. It dates back thousands of years ago. The Sanawa that were around, 1,200 to 1,000 years ago were definitely using the salt mine. They were trading it. What's interesting is the people down south, the southern Hohokam, they didn't really like the Sanawa as other cultures did, like the Prescott culture. So we believe that the Hohokam actually got their salt from the ocean, whereas other tribes like the Prescott culture, the Sanawa, obviously, maybe Mogollon also obtained salt through this mine, through trade. So yeah, that's a really fascinating mine to visit. And if you go to Tuzagut, Montezuma Castle and the Verde Valley Archaeology Center, they all have exhibits from prehistoric bricks of salt that were mined and pulled out of there. And you'll see that there's little blue streaks in them. And the most pure and best salt has the blue streaks. So yeah, that's a really nice added bonus.
That's incredible. I didn't even know that. But if somebody wanted to make a full day out of that as well, if you brought a pair of dry pants, for example, and you wanted to go to some other locations, you're right there. Is that one location? Is it open?
Here's my recommendation. Yes. So Tuzagut, Verde Valley Archaeology Center, and Montezuma Castle are all open. Same thing with Casa Grande, Pueblo Grande, and Mesa Grande. So everything's starting to open up, which is really nice. If anybody wants to learn more about the archaeology in the Verde Valley and even up in Flagstaff, because this culture, they were not only in Verde Valley, but they were also in Flagstaff, as I mentioned before in a previous lecture. I would possibly consider actually maybe booking a hotel or a campsite for Saturday. So go down there Saturday and check out the Verde Valley Archaeology Center, check out Montezuma Castle, check out Tuzagoot, and then come Sunday, we'll be going out on this outing. But those are three sites that I highly recommend. V Bar V is not open right now. It's a privately owned area, and actually the hosts live on site. So that's the only one that is still closed down. But Montezuma Castle, Tuzagoot, Verde Valley Archaeology Center, highly, highly recommend them. They're amazing places, and they have excellent museum exhibits.
Joe B saying that the Casa Grande was closed last week. I haven't checked, but we'll take a look and see. Because you went to the Tuzagoot, and it is open for sure, right?
Tuzagoot, Montezuma Castle, Verde Valley Archaeology Center, everything's 100% open there. With the museum exhibit in Tuzagoot and Montezuma Castle, they just opened that up about a week and a half ago. So yeah, everything's starting to get into gear. Tuzagoot is highly recommended. It's amazing. And you can actually go and walk through the ruins. It's really cool.
You know, the cool thing about that area is that there is massive amounts of stuff there in that valley up there throughout. I mean, another good, I'm trying to think, Prescott Day Trips, the Facebook group, superb Facebook group with stuff that's going on around there as well. But it's just another offshoot like Perry Mesa. It's just another offshoot like Gila Bend, Picacho. There is, it's another group that you would find more stuff than you could ever even dream of. And it's all over from the more mild type stuff to the extreme stuff. And, you know, that's what we're going to talk about a little later too, as we talk about is finding, locations, and we're kind of carrying that on from a couple other conversations about how do you find these places. But once you open that door, you know, you realize that these archaeologists knew where all that stuff was. And if you read their papers, what you find out is you find a lot of locations that you didn't even know existed by just following their locations. I have a paper. It's already loaded up here too, as well. Malcolm Rogers. Malcolm Rogers is he's my guy, right? He's the guy. I love his whole story, even though he had a little strange life, a little bit of weird life. He has papers written on him about the locations that he went to. He stayed Kingman down to Yuma. So he stayed on that side of the state, the Kofa, all the way up to Kingman and then down Wickenburg, but he stayed on that side, and his sites that he is seen is spectacular. Oh, and there's Keith. Keith put a blam on us right there. You know, one thing I haven't seen for a while that I'd like to pull up, because it's disgusting. I'm going to give him a couple, but I haven't seen this for a while. And if I can find it, unless I got rid of it, did I get rid of it? No, I didn't. Here we go.
I got that money. I want that money. I need that money. Give me that money, that money, that money, my money. Give me that money.
That's so stupid, but I love it. You know, he's going to get one more, and he's going to get a quick one. I think Arnold is coming out. Doesn't get much better than that. Thank you, Keith. We appreciate that, man. That's awesome. It doesn't get much better than that, does it?
No.
It doesn't get any better than that, except maybe that. To the chopper! So, there's so much to see up there. There really is. There's so much to see in that area. And I have there's about five or six locations that I have been planning to go to. Have you been to the Bullpen Ruins?
No, you know what? I've actually heard pretty highly of them. That's the one that we were talking about last week, correct, Jeff?
Well, you know what happened was we just had a cabal on top of that. We just had Don Barry,
oh,
and Don Barry hammered it, And, you know, we can't say we're going to give him Thank you, brother. I appreciate it, man. Thank you very much. Much appreciated considering the travel that we're getting ready to go do coming up, which we'll talk about in a little bit. You know, there's so much to see. I'm going to pull that up real quick for people just to show people that once you get going in these areas, in these locations, and you start to say, hey, I'm going to focus in on, for example, Perry Mesa, and then you study it, and then you do Perry Mesa. We did Perry Mesa for damn near a year, half a year. Then we did Gila Bend, and we studied it. And then we, you know, the next one was to go up to the Verde Valley. And then you start looking at videos. And that's part of the process that I use when I'm looking is I'll go in and look at places. And let's figure out which one that is. Bullpen Ruins. Here it is.
That's the one with the preserved roof beams. That's amazing. Yeah, that's
spectacular. I mean, yeah. And this is out. And this is the real deal.
Down the last slippery slope. And we're coming onto the ruins, and they're a lot bigger than I remember. They're really tall.
Look at the roof in that thing. You know, it looks like a cave. Look at the roof of that. That is spectacular.
Central Arizona, one of the biggest ruins I found in the area. It's pretty.
What's cool about that, I want to add a real quick comment. You'll notice that there was a petroglyph or a pictograph of two boxes with a bunch of little dots in that. My understanding is that actually represents the dwelling itself and how many people once occupied that individual room.
Really?
So I think I saw five dots in one, so that would represent five people that occupied that space.
I did not know that. Is that some type of ancient census?
It's pretty cool, huh?
It really is. I mean,
that back at ASU and when I was in the archeology program.
You know, I tell you what, that's a pretty cool place. I mean, and you know, that's what I do. That's part of my process is to go look at other people's videos, you know, just like hopefully yeah. People look at my videos or look at your videos. Right. I mean, that's why I make them is that, you know, and then, you know, from that video right there, you know, I found it. I found the location. I'm like, because I saw the video, you can go from the bottom, which would be living hell, but it could be done. But by looking at that video, I'm like, okay, he came from the top. So yeah. Then I start yeah. The process to figure out, you know, okay, so where's the road? Well, oh, there's the road. And all of a sudden you keep working that. But, you know, to get to be able to see places that nobody, you know, there's no welcoming committee. There's no, you know, there's no gift shop. I mean, you're out there with exactly. It by yourself, you know, and seeing this fantastic location. And, right. and man, that is like, that's the real deal, man. And that's yeah. Just one location of hundreds up there. I mean, hundreds.
Well, everybody asks me, you know, what are your favorite places to visit? Is it Tuzagoon and Montezuma Castle. And to be honest with you, I like those places because of the museum exhibits. I mean, that's just, I love the material technologies and the cultural understandings that they put together in them. But my favorite sites are the ones that no one knows about. The ones that do not have the gift shops and all the touristy, you know, buy a bar of soap and buy prickly pear cactus candy. I like going to the shit that no one knows about and that you can find those corn cobs on the ground.
Well, you know, you look at a place like that, that's pretty spectacular. And, you know, I watch these and much respect to all the people that produce these videos and go do that and risk life and limb to go out and look at these places and find these places and incredible. And they're still there. That's what's so cool about this deal is the that's one. There's 50 of them. I've got a couple more I'm going to show you, too. That one's on the list to go to this year. Definitely that one's on the list. And also the crack house. Have you ever heard of the crack house? And not, we're not talking about downtown. We're not talking about downtown Phoenix. We're talking about the original crack house. Have you heard of the crack house? Seriously?
I have heard of it. I have heard of it. I have never been. Same thing with Bullpen. I've never been to Bullpen. Bullpen is definitely on my bucket list. Jeff, we'll talk a little bit later this week about going to Bullpen too. I think you and I should check it out. And if it's a good area to go to, maybe we can schedule a second meetup or a second gathering.
Well, you know, part of what I do, again, is when people talk about how do you find things and do things. Well, you know, especially if you're a part of a group like this, for example, and there's many of them, which is not the only one. There's a lot of great ones. Like I said, the Prescott Day Hike or Day Trips is a great for your area, but there's a bunch of them, and these guys are doing a lot of cool work. So I look at these videos, and they also inspire me on places that I didn't know existed, you know, looking at Malcolm Rogers, you know, looking at his papers. There's places that are still out there that very few people like I think it's, was it Grouse, it'll come to me or I'll look it up. There's these places that he went to that you don't go to, you can't go to. There's one of them, you can't get on the land. It's a bombing range. It's government. It's a government, and it's one of the most spectacular ruin sites anywhere in the state of Arizona that you can't go to. And
that's funny.
He spent most of his time of all the places he went at that location, and loved it. And now we can't go see it because it's on government land and it's completely blocked off.
Well, that's funny you mention that because my friend Mark Severson, he was talking about that very site actually yesterday. And there's a Facebook group called Arizona Archaeologists. And there was a post up there that says, what is the most dangerous and craziest thing you have been through and seen while working CRM, which is cultural resource management, survey, excavation, so forth and so on. And Mark typed a comment and he says, I went across a bombing range to go to a ruin, a prehistoric site. And he says, they told us that the bombing would not be active. He said, we found out that they were actually doing live training while we were out there surveying.
Well, you know, that just makes it a little more exciting. That's a little more difficult than crossing a river, I think.
Yeah, what's you were talking about crack house. I didn't mean.
Well, let me pull. That's on the list as well. Now, what's cool about videos, for example, is that I was able to piece because I study these things. I mean, when I look at people's videos, I'm looking for landmarks. I'm looking for areas that, you know, is this makes sense? Does that make sense? Right? And then I match them. And then if I watch enough videos, well, just like this crack house, I found the crack house. And the crack house is also in the same range because I started piecing them together, three other videos from three other people. I went, oh, my God, the crack house is in the Devil Chasm chain. just like when you look at the Cavates being in that, you know, that same ridge line, yeah, right? Same thing. The crack house is on the same ridge line. Now it's a ways away, but the way to get there to all of them is when you found one, you could walk the ridge and go to two or three other ones. And that is it, where the Devil's Chasm is, right, which is another one on that very same list of places that, you know, rival Bullpen. Probably it's right. That Bullpen has that roof that's pretty unbelievable. I mean, but you know, Rogers Trough, you know, you go to Rogers Trough in the Superstition Mountains and you're going to see one of the most pristine buildings, roof intact, that you've ever seen out in the middle of nowhere. So, I mean, the cool thing about Arizona is they're out there. I mean, they are out there. So I'm going to pull the crack house. I'm sorry, go ahead.
They're all over the place. These ruins are everywhere where you find water, whether it is a natural seep or a riparian zone, there is likely a pueblo out there, whether it's a ball court or, sorry, ball court, which that reminds me, we got to talk because there's a ball court in Prescott Valley we need to go to. Whether it's a pit house village site or a hilltop pueblo, a cliff dwelling, a platform mound, anytime where you find water, there's sites. And Joe B, I think that's correct in Florence. And then Arizona Timeless, I'll answer these real quick. Arizona Timeless Tourist, I'm hoping that he can come out there with us too. So
Snake Gulch. Snake Gulch is a cool place as well. Snake Gulch. I mean, it just goes on and on. But this crack house, though, if you've never seen it, for those who haven't, I'm going to put this up just so you can see something that is another level spectacular as well. And it is another level. Let's get in here and figure out where it's at. There's Devil Chasm. Oh, there we are, the crack house. Okay, get ready. The crack house, there it is. How would you like to be climbing up this one and see this?
Oh, man. I thought we were on fairly level ground with it. Well, yeah, I guess considering what we...
I lost my mouse. I don't know where my mouse went.
Just went through. This is Oh, wait. We're right there. Whoa, that's so cool.
That guy kind of sounds like me. Look at that.
Whew. That's pretty cool. Do what? Oh, cool. Hey, Wes.
And try not to get off the hole that beam.
Now what my shoulder is.
I love that one right there, where it goes to another side of the peak.
This is so cool. It's a balcony.
Right.
Look at that. Oh, man, that's amazing. It's a tight fit, though. I'm going to come up this way first. All right.
No soft rock.
They're pointy though, sharp.
What? I mean, there's definitely a cavern to the left.
Okay, I can see the... Ow! Oh, I didn't need that part of my head.
Yeah, I mean, it just... There's a hole. Boy, it goes way up in there, but it gets tighter. I mean, it's... There's definitely... They used that.
Beams here.
Oh, yeah.
And then to lace the long-running beam.
That's incredible. Where is that at, Jeff?
That is on the other side of Roosevelt Lake by the world famous Devil Chasm. And that is one of the pieces. And then the devil that's here. And then the Devil Chasm is around. And it's pretty damn. When I saw that, I was like, you got to be kidding me. And again, then you also have, if you walk that ridge, from what I'm looking at when I did my research, I haven't been there, but then that gets you into Devil's Chasm, which is a whole nother, it's a full blown ruined three stories.
You could see that is built for defense too. That's not, I mean, yeah, they were probably occupying it, but that site, when you look at all those tunnels, that reminds me of those old Pueblo and Anasazi sites in Colorado, New Mexico, where you get these tunnel systems. I mean, purely defensive. I mean, you can see it's tucked back in the cliff where no one can see you. That site is incredible. And yeah, it's you know, whatever was going on, they did not want people going into their territory. That's a spectacular site.
Because that's a shot across from the Tonto Pueblo. You know, not Pueblo, but the wall, the cliff dwellings are there. And then it's due east of there across the lake.
I agree. So, I agree with Dean. I would be actually afraid of damaging it, getting into it like that. There's got to be another way to climb in except for going over those posts, because you saw that there's those cross posts where they climbed into that window. Right. Those cross posts are for stabilization.
So I saw three videos on this and they all go in the same way. Cause I've started to do research on it and I've not seen another way in. And that's not to say there isn't, you know, but I have not seen any other way in there, but that place is absolutely spectacular. I mean, that's another level, you know.
It is. We should definitely go to that one. I almost need a pen and paper to jot these down.
Well, you know, and that's part of just this process when you're going through it and you're seeing this stuff and you're like, okay. But the thing about a lot of these locations is that before you go, trying to get your schedule in, because, you know, if you were going, that's a massive climb. Anything you see about the Devil's Chasm, which I have a video loaded on it as well. It's serious stuff. I mean, you're talking about a serious climb. It's pretty incredible, but that's where you get that kind of, you know, quality of ruin. Right. Exactly.
Right. That's, man, I wish in the video he actually went down into that
He's
tunnel.
The only guy that I've even seen find that room, and I'm not saying others didn't, but he's the only guy in the videos that I have seen that actually seemed to find that little area that kind of went down, because, you know, my thinking was, my gosh, there's got to be something down there. You know, I mean,
I wonder if it opens up to a kiva area. So you'll get these tunnels, especially in the Pueblo and Anasazi world, you'll get these tunnels that actually run right into round circular kivas. And boy, I got to tell you, for a site like that, you know, not a lot of people are going in them. Those are the sites where you actually find full pots, you know, full pots or gigantic metates in the middle of rooms. You know, that's an incredibly well-preserved site.
Well, you know, I don't know if Dean's been there. I've seen a ton of videos, and I know when you go into the Devil's Chasm, you better be prepared. Oh, but the funny thing about the Devil's Chasm, though, is that I found another video to another set of ruins that they're all connected, though. And there is a road that'll get you to a certain point, and then it looked like, you know, it would take you a day, but you could hike the entire three different locations in the same day after making one climb instead of multiple climbs. And I don't know if it would get to the Devil's Chasm or not, but it definitely looked like it would have. What's Joe B say? It's definitely not have a Joe B hike approval rating. Well, I tell you what, those are. Well, let me pull up the Devil's Chasm real quick while we're looking at stuff.
Yeah, you know, let's do it.
On the list of things that that's the crack house. We don't want it. There's bullpens. Maybe I didn't do. Oh, there it is. Yeah, I did. I did do it. So let's see what these guys got. Oh, I was just going to say, here's all these. There is Jerry Arizona. He does a great job on videos. There's the unknown cameraman. He's pretty national. Let's pull him up and just see if we can get.
Oh.
And there is the climb. I like how he covers his face. But you climb up that ridge. And again, Jerry Arizona has a really good video of it. And there is a couple places where there are ropes in the valley that you can use to get. I don't think it's extreme like rock rope climbing, but there are some ropes to help you get in. But you climb up that valley. And then you think you might be there, but then you got to go up to the top right there. So these guys were buried in, you know, they weren't going to just get snuck up on. And so there's one set right there. But if you'll notice, a lot of them go around that corner. When you see the different locations, they go around that. But that's one hell of a hike. But, you know, look what you're looking at when you get up there. You're seeing stuff that you just don't see every day. Look at the quality of those walls. They're spectacular. You know, those beams that are 800-900 years old, they're still there, which is crazy. Right there. Look at that. Incredible places here. Unreal. You know,
couple things that I'll mention about that is you'll notice that there's stacking of potsherds. So quite a bit of people obviously visit that site. But on one of the Metades, you saw him pick up stone objects and there was a ridge in it and it looked like the edge was chipped in into a makeshift saw blade. So what that was actually used for is agave. So those are agave knives or yucca knives. And what they would do is they would attach them to sticks and they would lash them around and they would cut that center heart out before they baked it. So some of them, you get these really big examples of agave knives and other ones are a bit smaller. Some of them are broken. My expectation is those smaller ones were probably used for yucca. But yeah, those are agave or yucca knives.
How cool is that we live in a location in the state that that just you couldn't see all these sites. If you had a full-time job doing this and went out every day, you couldn't see every site that's out there. You couldn't. I mean, it's incredible that these things still exist like this. And we're only looking at that's just a little section. You know, that's the thing about this is you go to these locations or you start to study the Gila Bend, you find out there's 50 locations or whatever there might be. Or then you go up here and there's 40 or 50. And then you go to Perry Mesa, there's 600, 600 locations. And you don't even think that's possible. But through all the time, it's unbelievable how much is out there. You see, if you've been here, I haven't been.
Yeah, I've never been to Wupatki, but it's a pretty monumental site. That's definitely on my bucket list. I'm going to either do that this weekend or another time. I'm thinking this weekend I'll be done at Casa Grande or Wupatki, and then probably if I go to Casa Grande to Adamsville. I've never been to Adamsville, but that's a platform mound, Hohokam site. But I will add to that, Jeff, and I'll tell you, you talk about a lifetime of looking at this stuff and still not finding it all. You're absolutely correct. I'll expand on that, though. That we're just talking the state of Arizona.
Right.
We've got sites in Utah, Colorado, New Mexico, the Baja. I mean, we've got sites all over the place, everywhere in the American Southwest. We're just talking one state. There's no way that even the most seasoned archaeologist is going to find all these sites working full time.
Well, some of these guys did, for example. So another thing that I do is I look at papers, I look at articles, I study archaeologists, like the original, like the article, when we started this, we had different names of archaeologists that, whether it be Cosmo, whether it be
Byron Cummings. Yeah.
These guys. Right. And then you start to look at the sites that they dug. Right. So you start looking at this stuff. And so let's get in just for example, I share my screen and let's see if I can do this. Here's what I do. I go in and look at, this is a paper that Jerry Schaefer wrote on Malcolm Rogers. And all this article is just the white tanks. It says, there's where it is. This is the one you're not getting in. Okay. This is the one you'll never get to see. But there's 12 pages exactly what's in there that you're not going to get to see. He's got handwritten stuff. He's got all this. It's spectacular. It's unbelievable. It's another level. So I'll go through these papers and what I'll do is I'll stop this one though, and I'll come back out so I can get into the other one. And so I'll just research these papers and go in. And this is Malcolm Rogers, Arizona field work. So I'll go in these, take a look. Hopefully that's it right there. And I'll just read them. And so, Jerry Schaefer wrote this also, but then you see a map. Okay. Then you're like, well, wait a minute. He's got a map and there are like, I think 9 sites And so you get up here in Kingman, sites I wasn't even aware of. And he talks about Secret Pass in Meadow Creek. I've never heard of Secret Pass in Meadow Creek. You know, so that starts the process. I start Googling that. Okay. Look at this wall that's at that place.
And that's that thing
is incredible that I've never seen a picture of anywhere other than the San Diego Museum of Man, because he was the director eventually of the San Diego Museum of Man after being just an average guy. He wasn't an archaeologist. He was an average guy that loved to do this, self-taught, and then he created this, and he got so good, he became the head of that museum in San Diego, if you go. Now, regrettably, a lot of our pottery is in that museum. But so I'll look at this Kingman one right here. I'll look at these three here, right? And then I'll look down through here and look, and then I'll try to match them. And then I'll try to figure out, okay, where was this guy at, right? Because he only dug unbelievable places. So when he tells you that White Tanks is the most incredible place he's ever been, and this guy has been everywhere and done everything, then that place is another level and you can't go there. But there are other places, you know, that you always see him with no shirt on digging with a shovel. There is Bowes Wash right here. I do know another archaeologist who told me he knows where this is at. This is an incredible site. It's up by Kofa, if you look on the map. So I'll look at that site. I'll look at Bowes. I'll go back up here. I'll look at, you know, where it lines up. I think it's number 9. Bowes Wash. And they didn't, at the time that they put this paper out, which I think is in the 90s, they didn't even know where it was at. It's only been found as of the last, and I guarantee you, only a handful of guys knows, because there is a well that is a walk-in well, which made it incredible, and they found a plethora, I'll use the plethora word, of stuff in this hole here. Unbelievable amounts of stuff. This is the walk-in well here, and it, I guess, was loaded. So that, you know, that's what I do, is I go up. Here he is at White Tanks, which he said was the most incredible place he's ever been. Now, this is the guy that traveled all over Arizona and the Southwest, and when he tells you that. So I'll look at an article like this and go, okay, you know, where does this match? You know, what could I find? What could I find that's out there? So this one here intrigues the hell out of me, knowing that this cave is up near Kingman. And so, and you know, that, so you read the article and you look at it and you go, okay. And he tells you that one of the roof caves, there's two caves, one of them caved in. So, I mean, he tells you this information and then you match it. But look, he stayed on this side and then he's down here. And one of the most incredible things about him was he studied paths, you know, trails, trade routes. So he would study trade routes and figure out how they all connected. And that was his deal. So he would follow trade routes, figuring out how these people traded. And he would be really involved in the trade routes. And that was his deal. And here's a guy that was self-taught, who became the head of the museum in San Diego with not even being a degreed archaeologist. That to me is incredible that could even happen.
I'll tell you what, I'll be honest. I mean, I'm an archaeologist. I have worked in it, and I still do in many cases. The people that know the most sites are usually not even archaeologists, like folks like yourself, you know, that know of just loads and loads of sites from research and development and all kinds of stuff. So yeah, there's absolutely truth to that. Now, White Tanks, why can't you go to that?
It's on a bomb range.
Oh, that's the one that's on that bomb range. Okay. Yes. Yes. And then the one in Kingman, boy, I'm curious about that.
They're all open. The rest of them, you're, you know, you're the rest of them, you're, you know, and the thing about Malcolm was He only went to the places, it appears, that had ridiculous amounts of stuff. I mean, it they had to be full. And, you know, there's pictures of him with pots all. Oh, I mean, it's unbelievable. You can't even believe it. And so he only went to the locations that had some intrigue. So when he put those on the map, those nine, you know, and I think it's cool because it's on that site of the state. So that's a whole nother deal. And, you know, then you read it and you're like, oh, he went there. He went there. He went there. Oh, he talks about trade routes there. He talks about Kofa. He talks about, you know, the trade routes between the north the north and the south, going from the different locations that he kind of followed down. He talks about Wickenburg, which I didn't know there were places in Wickenburg, but he talks about Wickenburg, you know, the Wallapai, all up through there. You know, so the doors just open the more you start to do the research and you start looking at this stuff and you're just like, my gosh. And that's what makes it fun. You know, you look at things like when he's talking about secret paths and all this, and you look up some of this stuff and you're astounded that it comes up, you know?
Yeah. Well, a lot of those old guys like Cummings and Howry and Malcolm, They went after the sites where no one, you know, not even the Spanish knew about. Mm-hmm. Some of these sites are just incredibly well preserved, and yeah, I'd be interested to take a look at some of the pottery that he's pulling out of these. You know, I love pottery. Pottery tells you a lot about the cultures that were here.
Well, he was finding, and you know, he talked about white tanks being he wanted to homestead there. So he went there four times. He went there four times. And, wow, he's got a full page. He's got a full document of just that location. And it's incredible. It really is. And it's unbelievable. But it also sucks that you can't get in. You know, you can't get in there. It's ridiculous. It really is. I think it's ridiculous that, you know, that's land you should be able to get on. I mean, somehow, or on occasion, at least, you know, with a special pass, I guess, maybe, or some crap like that. I have been to Walnut Canyon, Keith, and Walnut Canyon is pretty cool. You know, some of these places that are out there, you know, that was like a condominium. The first, you know, like you walk into this like ancient condominium, you know, where there's, you know, and it's real similar to the Cavates as far as how it's structured in Walnut Canyon. There's some really cool stuff there. I really did, you know, you don't have to hike to the ends of the earth to have some type of fun. You know, you don't have to kill yourself to get up some of these locations, even though that can be part of the fun. But the reality of it is that it doesn't have to be that direction. But, you know, I was trying to think what else I had on the list. But, you know, I'm trying to think which guy, again, today, Malcolm was friends with a guy at Arizona University. And they were buddies. And that guy kind of did the south side, the south part of the state. And both of them, neither one of them were archaeologists. And they ended up being these, you know, top guys in the field. And I got his book coming. Both these guys have been dead for a long time. Or all three of them. Cosmo's been dead for about 80 or 90 years, but he lived a fabulous life. If you look up Cosmo's Mindelef, I mean, you know, he left here eventually after looking at the 50 sites. He became a reporter. He traveled Europe. I mean, he lived the life, you know, he really did, which was kind of cool. It's a great story. It really is.
And yeah, awesome. That's like Franklin Barnett. Franklin Barnett was an archaeologist up here. He wasn't formally an archaeologist, you know, by title. And God, man, that's what drives me nuts is it's like in some of these archaeology circles, they really, you know, oh, you're part of the club. Oh, you're not part of the club. Well, you know what? I've learned a lot from people who are not archaeologists, and I'm an archaeologist. So, you know, I mean, it's all information to share and learn from each other. But Barnett was a quote-unquote amateur archaeologist, and he dug one of the most famous sites up here called Fitzmaurice Ruin or Fitzmaurice Pueblo. Some amazing stuff was located out there. And, yeah, a lot of these guys who are doing formal excavation work, yeah, they might not have documented it as extensively as we do in modernity, but man, he was doing some really good work out there. Yeah. His archaeology work was nothing to be ashamed of. He wrote publications, excavations at Fitzmaurice Ruin. That's a really good one, and it shows you all the pottery and shell and effigies and argillite that they pulled out of that ruin. And actually, Fitzmaurice is less than a mile away from where I live. I mean, I can literally get on the mountaintop behind me and overlook the entire Pueblo.
It's incredible.
Yeah.
You know, so we're going to go on this tour, not this Sunday, but next Sunday. So we'll be back and prepare for that again. And so we'll be ready for that. We'll talk about that a little more on Tuesday's show again. Man, I want to thank everybody for coming tonight. I want to also thank Steve Lines. I want to thank for this donation. I want to thank Keith and Don again for contributing. What's going on? I'm going to do a four-part series on Chaco. I have been studying Chaco like a madman, and it's got me sucked in. That place has got me like sucked in. I'm like all in. So I'm going to figure out a date, and I'm going to haul up there. I'm going to try to do 2 days. I figure it's about 10 miles hiking from. I've been watching every video and studying everything. And I tell you what, I've got to go. I'm going to Chaco. That's on the list. That's on the travel plans. And, that's definitely going to be, it's going to be a four-part show. So it's going to have a lot of stuff.
Huh? I would love to go to Chaco. I have never been, but oh my God, you talk about monumental elite rulership, violence, cannibalism.
Well, I have these because I've been so immersed in this. I have this entire thought in my head about the whole process of Chaco. And I really, and whether it's crazy or not, because I have this, I won't say a vision, but I've had so much information thrown at me that this story in my head came about, which is no different. Most people have the same. It's not like something unique. I mean, I believe it was Mayans. I believe it was offshoots of Mayans that were the lords of Chaco. I believe that they migrated up here and they brought their magic, and their magic was their ability to be able to also deceive. And that's what Chaco was built on. I won't get into it but I could be completely wrong, but I'm fascinated by the place. And I think it's, you know, a place that I've got to put a stamp on. Again, I'm going to do four shows. I'm going to start going to places, and they're going to be longer shows, but these will be a Friday show. They won't interfere with, we might talk about it on this and the experience, but I'm heading to Chaco within the next three to four weeks. I'm looking for days, believe it or not. The wind is terrible up there. Oh, and I'm trying to find days that, you know, hopefully they know it's going to be somewhat calm, so we get good audio. Because again, it's looking at least 10, 12 miles hiking to go to where we want to go. But, I have to go there, man. Just like Jay says, always follow the signs leading your passions to these places. He goes everywhere, man. He goes everywhere. And so I have to go. There's these places I just have to seek out, you know,
Are you going to Pueblo Bonito?
Yes.
That's an awesome place. But yeah, Chaco's great. You definitely, without a shadow of doubt, you get all that Mesoamerican influence. I mean, they found chocolate there, the cacao vessels.
Absolutely.
With that mineral residue from the cacao, they actually found that in the vessels. And that comes from the southern tropics. So yeah, yeah. You do get scarlet macaws, you know, copper bells, lots of shell jewelry. You get all that Mesoamerican influence in Chaco Canyon, elite rulership, which is freaking awesome.
Yeah, it's just another level. And to see that, you know, when you look at these ruins that are out there, which we looked at tonight, they're pretty spectacular. You go there and then you see just that level 20, you know, from there. Oh, and you look at, you know, and what's so cool is that, you know, some of this thought, and I know this gets murky in the archaeology world, but, you know, the longer we're, you know, these cultures that were actually more advanced, that were older, you know, not less advanced, more advanced. And is there another one that's more advanced behind that one? Now we're getting into some of the Saturday shows. It's more Saturday kind of stuff, but you know, it all kind of bumps into each other. So yeah, it's pretty awesome.
Yeah. 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 It's good stuff. I mean, it keeps you busy. I'll tell you, I mean, you could research this the rest of your life and you know, we still won't go to all the sites that we want to. There's a lot of them out there, man. And I say, do it, everybody on here, do it while you still can, you know, because by the time you're 70, 80 years old, you know, it's tough to get out and start hiking these cliffs. So get out there and just enjoy it and do it while you can. That's for sure.
Hey, I want to thank Keith Larkin, Steve Lines, Tim Hofflin, Tom R., Wendy. I don't know the Facebook user. I wish I knew who that was. Who else is there? Ken Bush. Good to see Ken. We had Tom and there's Ken again, and there's Tim again. There's JEB Enterprises. Please follow his stuff. There's Bob Bencher. Had a great story from Bob on Saturday. There's the Big Chamook. Awesome. Who else is in there that I've missed? Dean, I hope you get well quick. Hope you heal fast. Mark, good to see you again, man. Joe B, good as always. And there's, I appreciate that, Keith. There's Mark. Awesome. There is the Arizona Times. There's Zen Woman. Oh, Zen Woman. Okay. That took me a minute, but that's excellent. There's Wendy again. And who else is in there? I hope I don't miss anybody. If I do, I apologize. Man, we had a lot of comments tonight. Thank you, man. That's awesome. I want to thank Jeff for coming on. We were just going to chat a little bit about the trip. We ended up rolling the whole entire show, which is awesome. It's great as always to see you.
Yeah. I appreciate you having me on again, Jeff.
Well, not a problem. Thanks for coming. And for Kim, I didn't see Kim. I know she's on there, but we got to give Kim the no show blues. Thanks for everybody that donates. We couldn't do this without your guys' donations, and I appreciate that. And thank you very much. I appreciate those that can donate when they can. And one thing you can also do is please share the information, you know, please share the videos. And thank you, Don. And man, thanks again. Again, I couldn't do it without you. We're going to shut this down with Kim's, the no show blues. And man, it's good to see you, and I will see you again. Thank you, Jeff.
Thanks, Jeff.
Take care, brother.
Likewise, man.
Thanks. Well, that's it, man. I appreciate everybody. Let's crank up the no-show blues and stay safe out there. And
in the valley, but today I didn't go.
There we go. Bam! That's a bam! I kind of like that. What is cranking?
I'm going to get drunk and smoke 3 packs of Marlboros.
Man, I appreciate all of you. Adios, amigos. Bam!
I got a wife at the house, but she got no love for me. I know.